has improved. GNPA has also improved 20.92%. Okay, and PCR continues to be high. This PCR is inclusive of technically written off cases. It is at 97.27%. Overall, the capital adequacy continues to be quite comfortable, and of course, this is without the, the cumulative profit, which we will take into account at the end of the financial year. Now, coming to the profitability, the movement between the Q2 of last year to Q2 of this year, as well as the half year to half year, has been analyzed in terms of its components. So you can see that the NII has had a major role. The improvement in NII has given the improvement in both the movements. Then we have had contributions from other operating costs. There has been some reduction there. Then we have had provisions and contingencies. Now that we had made over the past 3 years of the PCA quite a large amount of provision. Gradually, that intensity is coming down because we have continued to be at a high level of PCR. So overall, both quarter on quarter, that has shown improvement of 75%. Half year to half year has shown improvement of about 150% in terms of profit after tax. Now, coming to slide 10, this is the PL breakup. Again, I will not dwell too much, except to again emphasize that June 21 numbers show a spike because of those one-off that I mentioned. Interest income is the inclusive of those one-time items. Other income is also inclusive of that. Otherwise, the employee cost has...
Ladies and gentlemen, it seems we have lost the line for the management. We request all of you to stay connected while we reconnect the management. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for patiently waiting. We request all of you to please stay connected while we are reaching the management. Request all of you to stay connected. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please stay connected. The call will begin shortly. We request for patiently waiting. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your patience. We have the management line reconnected. Over to you, sir. You may please go ahead.
Yeah, we have lost some time, so we'll try our best now. So I will straight away take you to slide number, this is on the provisions, so slide number 12. So what I wanted to say was that there are certain movements of provisions which are reflecting in the aggregate provisions in the profit and loss account. Okay, so the one is that because of that the regrouping due to RBI Master Circular, the depreciation on investment, which was being shown under other income, is now shown under provisions and contingencies. Second, the provision for NPAs, it shows that write-back of 1,426 crore. Why such a huge negative figure is coming is because of two, three reasons. One is that the cases where we have done settlement, large cases, which are fully provided, not it, no. Then to the extent that amount is not recovered, we show it as write-off, that is given below, bad debts written off, 1,023 crore. Corresponding to that, the provision which is being held is shown as a write-back. So you'll find that write-back here. That is one. And second, we have this one case, all of you are aware, in Calcutta, Shrey company. So that is under High Court order, it was not classified as NPA. We had made the full provision, which was shown under standard asset provision. Now on the case being marked as NPA, after the High Court has permitted it, it is now this, the provision has come back to NPA provision. And therefore, overall, this also includes the provision for the first time NPAs during the quarter. We had a slippage of about 1,440 crore. On that also, there is the provision here. So overall, if you take all this plus minus together, that is the figure. Then we have also made some amount of, like in last quarters, wherever we feel that, it is considered prudential, we have made some provision for standard assets. Besides that, we also have this restructuring framework 2.0, under which whatever we have restructured, the details of that we already given in our stock exchange release. So the corresponding provision we have given here about 76 crore. Income tax is, there is no current tax provision because we have just carry forward. So to that extent, we have a DTA, the reversal of about 207 crore. Bad debts written off, I already mentioned. And recovery from written off cases, again, this is shown as a positive, that is a negative in brackets here. Then the reason is that earlier it was shown as income under other income. Again, due to the new master circular, it is grouped here. So it is a reduction of provisions and contingencies. And overall other provisions are there, some NCLT cases and ICA, all that. So those miscellaneous all provisions together are 132, taking the quarterly aggregate to 642. This is one thing I just wanted to take 2 minutes to explain this slide. So again, in the interest of time, I will straightaway take you to the liability profile on slide 17. We continue to maintain a healthy liability profile. CASA has improved further to 54.64. Both components of the savings and current account, both are holding steady. So just 1 minute, hold on please. I think we'll be switching from my mobile phone to the regular phone. Please hold on.
Hello.
Now I was on slide 17, the liability profile. So we continue to show the improvement, and I would like to say even that component of bulk deposits has further gone down. It is now practically there, 6.36%, which now is hardly any concern. But one thing is to be remembered, that going forward, it may not be within this financial year, but sometime or the other, as the corporate book grows and as the need for funding increases, we would look to fund a part of that also through bulk deposit. It is not negative to have a better, higher proportion of bulk deposits, because 6 is really, really low. So even healthy banks have a higher ratio than that. But that sort of thing we'll look at as and when some amount of growth builds into the balance sheet. On the next slide, we are just given some more details of this liability portfolio. So again, in the interest of time, I'll skip over this. We'll come to page 19. This is on the advances. The retail advances continue at a high level of about 67% of the total advances. Just as I have just now mentioned, as we re-enter the corporate market in a slow but gradual way, the amount of retail portion will come down. But we continue to remain committed to the strategic vision that we will not go back to those days where we are corporate heavy. We will continue to focus on having a majority share of retail in our portfolio. Within that retail portfolio, we still have, and traditionally we have been heavy on the home loan portfolio, which is a fully secured portfolio and well-performing portfolio that we have. There's a certain components like LAP and all that, where we had some amount of bad experience. We already discussed that in previous calls. We have put a control on that. Even personal loan also is a component of about 600 crore only out of this. So we continue to maintain a portfolio which is secured, relatively healthy and better yielding one, even on retail. But we'll look to grow here, again on the same principle, that with the adequate controls and with adequate emphasis on the quality. Priority sector, we are fairly well placed. This is on the next slide, page 20. We have, of course, part of it is because the advances portfolio has more or less remained steady. So we have been able to catch up with our PSL. We are fairly well placed. And earlier in that other cost and other income, I have mentioned that PSLC. So you can see that we, as and when required in any certain segment where we are falling short or where we are excess, we are able to either invest in PSLC or even generate income by selling the PSL. The treasury, again, I will not dwell on this. Overall, I will only say the modified duration which is given here, this includes both the entire portfolio is for 4.52, including the HTM, and for AFS, it is just 1.09. So we are fairly well placed to address the what are likely changes that may happen in the interest rate curve. On the COVID provision, we are given whatever is the provision that we have. We are well and adequately provided for any stress that may emerge on the COVID-19. On the outlook side, what we are seeing is that definitely the amount of stress that has emerged due to COVID-19 is not as much, and quite well below what was apprehended when we started making this provision. The asset quality is depicted in the next slide, 25. Again, I will not dwell too much on details. You are familiar with the trends in our numbers. So the overall net NPA stands at 1.62 and provision coverage stands at 97.27. One minor detail which I would like to mention, this is the, as RBI has in the master circular said that when there is a reverse repo, which is not an overnight reverse repo, we have 7 days and 14 days that we have classified under advance. Based on our understanding of that circular. So that, because the advance is, this one has increased, it's at net NPA percentage, even both for the current quarter and we are recast for the previous periods also. So the comparative is on the same basis. NPA movement is given on the next slide. Overall, as I mentioned, the slippage has been about 1400 crore, and there is existing NP increase of about 100 crore. But the settlements upgrade, as well as the return off due to everything put together, is much higher than that. So resulting into a net decrease in the NPA, it has come down to 34,400 from 35,594. The slippage ratio has been 2.2, but we expect that overall for the year, it would be that not be the, a multiple of this, that is annualized, will be restricted to about 3% for the full year. And the credit cost for the quarter is 0.3, but the overall for the half year it has been 0.6. We expect that for the full year it will be about 1.5%. Then the next slide, again, will not dwell on it, is just a position on the NCLT cases. On the slide 28, this gives you the SMA position. In June, we had seen the status of the SMA position, and some concern was expressed on the increase in the SMA1 position. Now, SMA2 position. Now you can see that it has come down. There are two reasons for that. One is, of course, at that time we had assured that we'll be doing active follow-up, and we are very confident that several of these problems which are in that SMA2 category will be addressed. And we have it was mentioned last time also that some structural changes have taken place in the bank. We have now dedicated verticals attending to this sort of the work, and this has given the results. In addition to that, we also, as you know, in the restructuring slide I had mentioned, that we have done some amount of restructuring for the under the RF2. So that has also resulted in reduction in this SMA category. So overall, the SMA position is looking quite better now. Capital, that is slide 30. We are fairly well placed. Nothing more to say. We already mentioned the figure. And this next slide is on the shareholding pattern. There's again nothing, no major development in the quarter which needs to be mentioned here. Now the digital footprint and all these are the numbers which we have given here. We continue to focus on improving the digital footprint, which is in line with the industry. And we have taken technology initiatives, and also we have taken manpower initiatives. We've taken people on board now from outside that will help us both in our IT initiative as well as the digital banking initiative. We hope to enhance our digital offerings. We also hope to enhance the IT and digital experience of the customer, and thus give a much better digital footprint going forward. Now, I will not go into all these subsequent details. In the interest of design. Financial inclusion also, the figures which we are given here are there. I will not dwell on those. Straight away, the subsidiaries that we have given position is on page 40. Now all are profit making. They are positive and they are giving us a return. Now the way forward here, the 2-3 items which are mentioned here, some of which I have already described. Credit cost we expect to be about 1.75. for the year, and the next slippage will be 3% or less for the year. We also said that the net NPA level would be at the most 2.5% by March, and we aim to bring it down further to the 2% in the next couple of years after that. And the NIM, as I said, will look to maintain at least 3%. Now these are the this comes to the end of the presentation. I will stop here so that we can start taking your questions.
Sure, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may please press star and one at this time. The first question is from the line of Pranav Tendulkar from Rare Enterprises. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks a lot for the opportunity. Sir, I have a few questions, so just be patient with me. So, total restructuring, including COVID restructuring, is how much? So, your press release suggests that it is around 5 to 6 crores, but that is COVID restructuring. And about that restructuring, total if you make, how much it is?
Yeah, COVID, that restructuring we have given that, there were, one was resolution framework 1.0, then 2.0.
Correct.
And MSME, these three parts are there. So in one, it was a total 1.29% of our standard advances.
So can you just tell me the absolute numbers? It will be easier.
Absolute was 1,619 crore.
Right.
The second was 1,993 crore, which is around 1.59% of the total standard advances.
Right.
And the third MSME is 569 crore. So total makes 4,181 crore, which is equal to 3.3% of our total standard advances, and which is well within the expected norms.
Right. And before COVID, how much it was?
Before COVID, that there is other standard restructured
The mention
that you have made on the page 2 of your press release, the format A and format B, and then there is a 5826 figure and 5722 figure. Where is this figure coming from, that crore? So there are two tables, format A and format B, that is according to RBI that you have presented, and there is a 5722 crore figure on the column B of format A and column E of format B, that is 526 crore.
Yes, that is in the stock exchange.
Yeah. On the second page, after all the release press result tables are there, you have mentioned that.
It is in the stock exchange. See, this figure which is given here in format A, format
yeah.
B, that exposure first of all, exposure includes even non-fund based exposure, and secondly, that was the exposure as at the time of restructuring.
Correct.
The figure which has been given by MD now, that is the fund based outstanding.
Perfect, sir. Perfect.
And that is as on date, that is 30th.
Perfect, sir. Thanks a lot. So, second question is on the NIM that you have produced in June, that was 4.01. So, you explained that there was a interest income reversal on Kingfisher. So, what is the sustainable NIM here, and what was the impact in last quarter of Kingfisher? So, I missed last quarter call. So, sorry for that.
So, the sustainable NIM is what I had mentioned. We are looking at maintaining a NIM of 3%.
More than
3%. At least, that is the NIM.
Right. So, 3.02 in this quarter would be the bottom.
Yeah, is the run rate that we will be expecting. Some quarters you can expect this spike. And because we were the bank exposed to lumpy corporate,
right,
which we have provided, and so sometimes when a recovery happens, to that extent, that spike will happen.
Right. So, sir, X one-offs, how much was the NIM for last quarter?
All-in was 4.4.
Excluding
that, it was 3.10.
Perfect. So, second thing is that you have mentioned there are three advances, right? So, there is one advance which is balance sheet advances, which is net X of problem assets. Then there is gross advances, which is around 1,60,000 crore. And then what happens is that you have mentioned also two types, that is one split includes services and one split doesn't include services. So what is the difference between it? So on the page 19 of your slide, there is a gross advances as on September 2021. In one thing you have mentioned, so the split that you have given, proportion 37% corporate, 12% MSME, 13% agri and 38% retail.
Okay.
And then on the bottom right corner, there is also a part of services, which is around 24,889. So where does services go in this table above? What is the proportion like? Where it is included here? Because the calculation gets confusing a little bit.
Right, because services can be in both corporate and retail. So it depends. Because services is the industry categorization given by RBI based on the harmonized industrial classification which government has adopted.
Okay.
In there. So that service industry can be a large one. For example, you take something like a security agency.
Hmm.
Okay, or anything else. And there can be some the small time agency which is offering, say, cleaning services.
Right.
So which would become as a SME business or something.
So it is better to take that 60,093 crore, which is a personal loan. That is a actual retail figure. We should not take the personal loan as 52,806 in the just chart below. That is right. So 60,000 is the correct.
That is
figure, right.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So second thing is that there is a employee costs Q on Q. If you see employee costs, so this quarter employee costs were around 698 crores, and the same quarter last year were around 789 crores. So, what is all included in this figure? Is it the latest by BPS included in this? Is the pension assumptions are fully provided for? So, can you just spend some time on what will be the actually employee expense per quarter going forward in this year and next year?
Yeah. Two things happened. In September 20, first of all, we were going towards that bipartite settlement. So, we were making provisions for that. Okay. So that provision, based on the estimates from quarter to quarter, there was some fluctuation based on the latest position in the negotiation and what was the intimation coming from IBM. Okay. Then the second thing was, of course, the movement in interest rate. The movement in interest rate affects the valuation of employee benefits, particularly the retirement benefits.
Right.
So this year, the interest rates have been fairly steady. They have not impacted the valuation of retirement benefits so much. Also, the provisioning for the coming settlement, that has been done away with because the settlement is already in place. Rebate scales are taken effect. So it is coming as a regular. We don't have to make some estimates that will keep fluctuating. So due to these factors, one has seen the variation between Q2 of last year.
Right.
Otherwise, the employee component more or less is the same.
We have not 698 to 700 crores per quarter expense.
Pardon?
No, so 698 to 700 crores will per quarter expense this year, and next year we could assume, say, 700.
But this valuation of employee benefits will impact. See, right. If we are looking to a situation now where the rates have bottomed out.
Right.
So now, if not next quarter, going forward by March or elsewhere, there will be some impact on retirement benefits that will be come.
Correct. If interest rate goes down, no? If interest rate goes up,
then correspondingly there will be a valuation hit on G-Sec.
If it goes up, then there will be no additional requirement. But we normally do not write back.
We are not
writing back. But if there is a reduction in interest rate, then we have to make additional provision.
Correct.
And we cannot write back also because it is a funded liability. So we cannot take back money from the trust.
So if the interest rates are rising, then to that extent we will be saving on that one. Only expenditure part will be there. AS15 will additional burden may not be there.
Right, sir. So second thing is that on the other income split, can you just maybe I am missing it, the split between core operating fee, Forex and treasury profit out of 846 crore. Can you just give me split for that?
Yeah. So in this quarter, we had a commission exchange brokerage of about 436 crore. Then it was the valuation of investment. That profit is about 205. Sorry, not the valuation. Sale of investment is 205.
That is 405, no?
205.
Okay.
And there is a net revaluation loss of 32 crore.
So that is minus 32.
Minus 32. Then forex income is about 170 crore.
Right.
Then dividend is 13. And then we have some miscellaneous income. All together is about 54 crore. That is the aggregate 844.
Perfect, perfect. So same figures for last year and last quarter, will it be possible to give?
Yeah, sure. I'll read out, but it might be difficult for you to note down all the details. We can send it to you by email or.
Okay,
I'll read it out. For September 20, commission exchange brokerage 424. Then profit on sale of investment 499. Valuation loss 135
minus.
Okay, then there is a forex income 26 crore. Dividend income 8. Miscellaneous income 59.
Perfect.
And June 21, commission exchange is about 404. The profit on sale is 690. This is the first quarter sale on GSEC. Okay,
that you can explain why it was high.
We had discussed earlier that because that the interest rate was position was favorable and used that situation and encashed the gains which are there,
Right.
And profit on revaluation of investment is a plus instead of a minus, is a plus 92. Then we have the forex income of 164. Dividend income of 26 and miscellaneous 23. So aggregate is 1400.
Perfect. And was there a strategic sale last year, same quarter, something like that?
The profit on sale of investment was 499.
So in that there was some sale, right?
Yeah, there was sale of both NSDL, I think. So you want that figure on?
Yeah.
Okay.
So that 499 was not all treasury. It had some strategic sale, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, it does. 110 crore.
110 crore was from NSDL.
Yeah.
Perfect.
NSE.
Okay. So also during the introductory remarks, you mentioned that there is a reclassification of other income and provisions. Can you just explain that for a little bit detail?
Very simple. RBI has said that the recovery from return of cases should be shown in provisions and contingencies.
Okay.
Because probably the logic is that since write-off is being shown there, recovery also should be shown there.
That is why your June provision is changed in this presentation from last year. That is the reason. And other income has changed correspondingly.
So the second reason is that where the investment, where it is a pure mark-to-mark minus coming, because we are not allowed to take plus anyway. So mark-to-mark, purely mark-to-mark minus, that is shown under other income.
Right.
But if it is a non-performing investment, as per their norm, and we make a provision as per the norm for NPI, that provision is to be shown as provisions and contingencies.
Okay, perfect.
So that also we have shifted to provisions.
Perfect. And sir, what was the provision for SREI that you did for this quarter? I understand that you mentioned that it was in standard provision and now it is in NPA provision. But
we have moved it from standard to the NPA. It is about 300 odd crore. 340 crore, right, if I remember that. 340 crore is what I remember. 370.
It has not impacted the PBT, right? Because it was already there in standard.
It is just movement from one type of provision to another.
Right. Sir, also, I just have this query that I was just saying your past 6-7 years, and you have, if I'm not wrong, written off something like 80,000 to more than that over last 4-5 years. So can there be a significant recovery, because the accounts that you have written off are in that infra and metal space, which actually has a good time now cyclically. So am I right to assume that the recoveries will be much higher from that written off pool, which is not there in your network, and your network could be boosted?
Yeah, actually, all the banks are working towards that. See, 2-3 initiatives had happened. We are aware of this NCLT process. Unfortunately, both because of some procedural reasons, also because of COVID. There has been a certain amount of delay in that. The entire industry is looking forward to normalization of that process. Now that things are coming back and physical hearings, everything is back to normal. So one can hope that a few cases will get resolved now and the process will get normalized. The other thing which, of course, the industry is looking forward is this bad bank. So that proposal also has been in the works for some time, and now it has more or less reached the stage where it will be launched now. So that could also give some amount of, first of all, of course, it will be fully written off cases which will be going in the first stage. So that, as far as GNP, all that, there is not much impact. But some amount of upfront realization in terms of the cash that we will get. And secondly, there is a time-bound program there for NARVL to get this resolution done, which hopefully they will be able to do because they will be aggregating on a very large scale. And being an aggregator of that almost a major chunk of the debt, they will be hopefully able to, either through NCLT or through a normal resolution process, be able to bring about positive outcomes which have not been possible for individual banks. So that, if you put these two together, there is some amount of hope now, much more hope than what was there 6 months back or anything, that we will be able to gain more recoveries from this fully provided and written off case. But it is very, very difficult to give any timeline prediction that it will happen in this quarter or in this half. They are subject to certain procedures and also certain legal challenges which the borrowers may have. So there can be spikes here. I mean, it will come in terms of, it will come in sporadic way. We cannot have a regular pattern.
Right. So last question from myself. So this ARC outstanding is how much? And when you say investment depreciation and take it in credit cost or provisions, is it basically ARC receipts depreciation or is it anything else also?
Of course, there is in the chunk of it, we do have certain SR from earlier transfers to ARCL. In the recent past, we have not done much of portfolio transfer to ARCL, even those SRs are there. As and when the valuation comes on a time basis, based on the provisioning norms for that ARCL, so that provisioning hit is also there in the depreciation of investment. But there is also the main chunk of this depreciation pertains to the equity and preference share and non-convertible debentures that we hold in companies that are linked to the debt that we have to those companies. They might have come either through direct subscription or through conversion of debt dues to this form of investment. So there are certain norms prescribed by RBI on how you treat this as performing or non-performing, and if it gets classified as non-performing, then how do you do the provisioning service? So this major chunk of this is because of that.
Thank you, Mr. Tendulkar. Request to join the queue for any follow-up. Also, participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star and one at this time. Next question is from the line of Maruk Adajania from Elara. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hello, sir. Sir, I have a couple of questions. Firstly, there are the new family pension norms. What will be the likely impact of those on your wage bill? Can you quantify?
Yeah. So, as of now, our bank is slightly different from other public sector banks. We are classified as private sector. So, we are not in the same category as far as family pension is concerned. So the matter is being examined. So it is not at there is no decision yet on whether that family pension, which has been granted by the other public sector banks, will also be considered in the same way and to the same extent as by IDBI. This matter is yet to be considered at a policy level. So if we do actually do that, we have made an internal assessment. And we have looked at, because as I said, the settlement was done last year, and till then we had made certain provisions for the employee cost. We are in a position to say that for this year at least we are covered for the liability that if at all it may arise from that. So we'll see as it go forward. Once a policy decision is taken in this regard, then we will make an accurate assessment on what is required, and most probably we'll have to start making provisions from the next financial year. In this financial year, we do not envisage at this stage that we'll have to make a provision.
Just we may add that, you know, the as per internal assessment, what Mr. Sitaram has said, the amount is not very large, and in any case, RBI has permitted to make provision in 5 years. So if that is happening, so it will be very easily, it can be absorbed. There will be no much impact on the profitability of the bank.
Got it, sir. Sir, what is your exposure to Air India and Shree?
Air India, we don't have exposure.
Shree, I already mentioned, we have made provision of 370 crores, that is the full 100%.
Oh, that's 100%. Okay.
Yeah, and Air India, we don't have exposure.
And DHFL?
DHFL is now the settled return of, there is no question of that exposure.
Already we have recovered almost 200 crores.
Yeah. What was recovery? And there is no more exposure.
So, what was the recovery?
We had an exposure of 980 crore, and pro rata, like the other banks, we have also recovered part cash, part instruments.
Okay, and the entire amount has been written back through other income?
It was a fully provided account.
The other income now, technically, write off also, as Mr. Sitaram had explained, it has to be taken in provision reversal.
Yeah.
So, it has been taken as provision reversal, cash portion. And NCDs, in any case, some NCDs were also there. These are kept as debenture whenever these are due. Whenever we will be getting interest, and at the due date, we will be redeeming that amount. But the cash portion has been treated as provision reversal.
Yeah.
So the NCD also should be treated as provision reversal, no? Because we provided 100%.
See, NCDs, when it has come from loan to investment, so along with that, the corresponding provision also goes to NCDs. So NCDs will be reflected at a net book value of zero, or for systemic requirements, maybe 1 rupee. So the provisions continue there. When we recover the NCD, at the time, that provision will reverse.
Okay, so just now, what is written back is only the cash portion.
Yeah. We continue to hold the provision for NCD, which was earlier held for the loan.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to participants, please press star and one if you wish to ask a question. Our next question is from the line of Jay Mundra from BNK Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi sir. Thanks for the opportunity. Sir, on Diwan NCD again, so can you sell those NCD as of now, or you will wait till maturity?
They are not listed. And we all know that several NCDs which are listed also, there are hardly any volumes in the market to justify that we will be able to go to the market and sell. So even if they were technically listed. So as of now, these are NCDs which are not really sought up by anybody. So at this time, there is not much prospect of selling it unless you want to take a heavy haircut on it.
No. Understood, sir. And secondly, sir, on this change in net NPA percentage and in provisioning, accounting from other income to reduction in the provisioning, is it mainly because of this master circular, or there was some other specific circular as well? I mean, because this is happening for the first time, right?
Yeah, and it is based on that master circular.
Right. So this was, there was no specific circular to say so. It was only part of this master circular, right, which comes every year anyway.
No. It has come after several years. This is this master circular on disclosures and presentation. Last one had come in, I think, 2014 or 15. And this is being updated after 6-7 years now. And they have put it on the website. They said it is effective from the date of being put on the website. That is sometime in August. September.
And secondly, sir, on restructuring, so this quarter, if I look at the restructuring provisions, you had a 76 crore restructuring provision and 800 crores of standard assets provisioning. So and then the this quarter you had some reasonable restructuring also. R2 is around 2000 crores.
Mm-hmm.
So ideally there should be at least 10% restructuring. Is this number right? I mean, how should we look at it? That the what explains this higher 800 crores of standard assets restructuring and very low restructured assets provisioning?
Actually, those two are not related. So first, let us look at the restructure. See, this is the net provision which is there. So what has happened? The one or two big size loans which have become NPA. Okay, they were also restructured cases. So the provision has gone away from restructured. It has gone into NPA provision. To that extent, therefore, the net amount of 74, you are not able to correlate with the quantum of restructuring during the quarter. Because we have made a gross provision for that restructuring during the quarter. Also, there is a reversal because there are one or two large cases which have become NPA. The corresponding restructuring provision and everything has gone shifted to NPA provision. And therefore, it is a credit in this restructuring. That is the explanation for restructuring.
Right.
Okay. Now, coming to the standard asset, that is now also again a sum of a couple of movements which are there. For example, SREI, which we have provided for, so that standard asset provision has also gone to NPA. So to that extent, there is a movement from standard asset to there. In addition to that, on a voluntary basis, like we have been doing now consistently for nearly the past 2 years or so, wherever we feel that in this cases, there could be some, the weakness in that or where in anticipation of that. So we continue to make on a conservative basis provisioning. So this is what we have done in almost all the quarters previously. We have done also here, we identified some cases. We made some specific standard assets. It may not be necessary. If at all it is not necessary, then as the future events unfold, then we will reverse. Mm-hmm. But we would like to continue a conservative approach here. We don't again face some sort of a situation that we faced in 2017.
So your standard assets provisioning includes some amount of contingent provisioning or counter-cyclical provisioning in that sense.
You can call it that.
And in addition, that for COVID, that 863 crore in provision which we had made, that in any case we are continuing. We have not used it so far. In addition, that restructuring which you are referring, maybe that restructuring for COVID, we had made 484 crore provisioning. Out of that, 479 has been used. So that, no additional provision was required for that COVID restructuring.
Okay, so just to clarify, this restructured provisioning or the COVID provisioning of some 800 something, that includes the restructuring provision, right? Standard assets restructuring provision.
It doesn't include. That is over and above. Earlier we had done and we have given the detail. That amount we are holding separately. And we didn't draw from that for the restructuring during this quarter. Though technically we could have done that, the whatever restructuring has happened during the quarter, we have provided for it.
This surplus we are carrying, 863.
Yeah, that 863 we are not touched, though technically we could have used some part of it. Again, on a conservative basis, we are going cautiously on this thing. We'll wait till March, and by then we will know what is actually required, what is not required. We'll take a call at that.
Okay. So, sir, your slide 24, which has this COVID-19 provisioning 1,347 crore, this is over and above your specific provisions, but does this also include restructured provisions? No.
It includes that 484, which is the restructuring part.
Right. Okay.
And then the rest part is what Andy mentioned, that the second wave we have made additional provision of 500. Then in the first quarter of last year, that we had made, and this on June 20 also we had made. All these three provisions over and above that 484, that also we are keeping as it is. We are not yet touched those provisions.
Understood, sir. And last question, sir, on my side, on your NPA outlook, I think you have mentioned it clearly that you want to wait out for some more quarters, maybe two quarters more before, so that you see the final impact of COVID But if you can sort of highlight, sir, because what is it that is sort of area of concern? Is it like MSME where you are seeing some sort of a potential issue, or your retail? Because corporate looks like sorted, and you anyway do not have much MSME and retail. So what is driving this caution? That would be helpful.
Nothing specific. What we are looking at is that when we started the year, where there was a large amount of apprehension on the second day. But as things have developed, gradually these anxieties have come down. As we stand today, now most of that anxiety has ebbed away. And it looks like we are able to manage that. So and even this restructuring that we have done, not much given the size of the portfolio that we have. So it looks like both the MSME, agri, and the small business people, all of them are able to weather this COVID storm much better than what was apprehended at the beginning. So, but there is that but. Nobody knows because this is an epidemic which we never. Very difficult to predict now 3 months down the line whether this trend will maintain or whether there will be a drop in all this the number of cases, infection, and it will be far better, or will there be a third wave now? And will there be further stress and further? So that is the only thing, that is that unknown factor. So we have gone through a bitter experience. I mean, not only the PCA and the related thing, but just when we are coming out of it, we had to face this COVID. So it has been quite a thing. So the conservatism emanates from that. So there is no particular rational reason. We don't have a particular area of concern in our portfolio. It is doing fairly well. The restructured portfolio, we have to wait for some time. That whether that also will hold well. It looks like it can, because the overall climate is improving.
And in fact, that will again corroborated by the fact that our SMA level, if you see, SMA level has been continuously declining. So in June, my SMA 2 was 2,367. Now, as on 30th September, it was 947. Total SMA 0, 1. And when we give this SMA number, we give the all, not more than 5 crores. Entire everything we are giving. It is only 5,024. So which shows that, you know, our efficiency ratio is now has reached 96% in retail. So which was earlier used to be, in fact, 94, 95. Now even this COVID, post-COVID, it is 96%. So I don't think there is any risk, but just to be on conservative side, he is giving that statement.
And we must remember that though we have come out of PCA, there is at least 1 year window now where RBI will be looking at us closely. And so we would like to demonstrate that everywhere that we are not going too much adventurous, we would like to continue a conservative stand till we are very sure that we are now strong enough and we can go ahead with much more calibrated. That we'll see. I mean, March would be some sort of a watershed where we'll take stock and we'll take a call on all this at that time.
No. So I agree with you, sir, that the situation is improving and your SMA levels are also very steady, but it does not corroborate with your last slide, which says that the net NPA will be below 2.5, which anyway is below 1.7 now, and you are saying that net slippages will be below 3, which is even lower than this now. So I don't know, how does these two things add up with the outlook, with the general environment that you have?
Excellent question. So a perspective, if you look at, we have made some standard asset provision. Take a worst case scenario where the probability of that worst case is very low. But suppose that worst case scenario, that where we have seen that we need to make a standard asset provision, suppose all the thing becomes NPA. Then we have seen that what will happen to our net NPA. And that is, again, we are taking a very extreme, because we don't want to surprise the market with a figure which is higher than what we are giving as a guidance. So that's why we have put that number there. It is already lower than what we are guiding earlier. So to that extent, yes, some positivism has already come. But we don't want to really, again, go very aggressive on that. let this trend of COVID stabilization establish itself, let us have some amount of confidence in the outlook for the economy, then we will definitely be much more balanced rather than being too cautious.
But you are right, I think I am not quite apprehensive that we will cross 2. We will be well within the 2 level only. I agree, but that is done just for, if something very wrong happens, then he is giving that number.
Understood, sir. Thank you so much for your time, sir, and all the best.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that would be our last question for today. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Kunal Shah for closing comments. Thank you, and over to you.
Yeah, thanks to the entire senior management team of IDBI Bank for answering all the questions and giving the detailed explanations. And thanks to all participants for being there on the call. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks to...
Thank you. Thanks and for giving us the opportunity to host. Host you, sir. Thank you. Yeah.
Pleasure replying to your questions. So let us hope we'll meet next time. Thank you very much.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of ICICI Securities Limited, that concludes this call. Thank you all for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.